Kidarkenu Bakodesh. I'd like to start with a beracha. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Shakol Nihiya Bidvaro. Good evening, Rabotai. Tonight's words, Leilu Nishmat, Liza Brachia Bat Kitzia, Ruach Hashem Tenichena Bechan Eden. And the fact that her children stepped up tonight to sponsor an event of Torah, there should be an incredible Aliyah Neshama for her. What nachat a mother must have to look down and to see her sons spreading Torah in Am Yisrael. For that, nothing can compare. It was only a few days ago that we looked into a haftarah that cried out to us a message. And what a message it was. It was a message that screamed Sefirat Haomer. It was a message that screamed Rabbi Akiva and his students. It was a message in the Navi that opened up our eyes to where the mind must be in these 49 days. And I'm talking about a story that many has somehow or other walked right by. Sometimes in the Haftarah we don't appreciate the gems, but we just read it. It was the Haftarah Mitzorah. It was a haftarah that spoke about the four lepers. A haftarah that spoke about the four mitzoraim. And it tells us an incredible story. There were four men that they were mitzorah. They were lepers with leprosy. And you know that the mitzorah, they're pushed outside of the city. They're pushed mechutz lamachaneh. And they cannot stay with the people inside the city. So they're outside by the gates. Now at this time, Klal Yisrael happened to be at war. And there was an incredible siege that was going on around the city. No food was coming in. No food was going out. Nobody was going in and nothing was coming out. These four lepers are standing by the Sha'ar Ha'ir. And they say to each other, how are we going to survive? You know, generally the people of the city would bring food outside to those who are mitzorah. But this time, there was no food inside to bring out to anyone who was outside. So one of these men says to the other three, what are we going to do? We have nothing to eat. We're going to die. Even if we go into the city where we're not allowed, there's no food there. And out here, there's no food. So what are we going to do? So one turns to the other and says, you know what? We might as well go out to the enemy. And we'll give ourselves up. If the enemy kills us, well, we'll die anyways. If the enemy feeds us, we'll get food. So we're in a better position that we're in right now. And that's exactly what they did. These four lepers, these four mitzoraim, they pick themselves up and they walk out to the goyim, to the enemies. And they come out to the camp. And they see thousands of tents, and they see cattle, and they see sheep and horses. And as they come up to the tents, they can't believe their eyes. There's nobody there. They go to the next tent, and to the tent after, there's nobody around. Thousands of tents. Where's the army? This was the army that was surrounding the city and laying the siege. And yet, when they went out to the tents, to the area of the siege of the army, nobody around. Where is everybody? So they go from one to the next. As they enter the first tent, they see wine, they see grapes, they see food. They start to eat. They haven't eaten in days. And after they go from one tent to the next, they see that the fires that were burning were still hot. So the army was here not too long ago, but where are they now? So as they're going through the entire Mahaneh, they can't believe their eyes, but the enemy is gone. So one of the Mitzora'im turns to the other and he says to him, "Hey, we just ate. Now we're okay. But back in the city, Klal Yisrael, they still think that they're under siege. They don't know that the army is gone. They don't know that the enemy disappeared. So let's go back and tell everybody. We'll give them a Yeshua. We'll give them something to be happy about. They're saved the way we were saved." And that's exactly what they did. They ran back to the city. And they come into the gates. And these four lepers, they start screaming, "There's a Yeshua to Klal Yisrael. We were saved." And at first the people thought they were crazy. "What are you talking about? We're here under siege. The enemy is outside. They're trying to break our walls and come in and kill us. What are you telling us we're saved?" He says, No. "We were just out there. The enemy's gone. There is no enemy. They ran. They left." The word comes back to the king, Yoram. And the king says, "Something is funny. I think this is a trap. I think the army made it look like they left so that they'll draw us out of the city, so that when we come out to inspect the tents, at that moment they'll jump on us in ambush. This is a trap." Says the king, "You know what we're going to do? Let's be smart. We'll send out two spies, two men. Let them go out and figure out what happened to the army of the enemy. And then we'll find out if the coast is clear, or maybe this is an ambush." And that's what they did. They sent out two men, and the men couldn't believe it. As they came to the camp, the tents were there, the animals were there, the fires were still going, the army was gone. They looked up the hills, they looked at the mountainsides. Maybe they're laying some sort of an ambush. Gone. They're nowhere to be found. And then they start making their way back to the waters, to the ocean, where the ships of the army originally sat. And the ships are gone. And they see that the clothing of the soldiers actually were on the floor in a line going all the way up to the water, looking like that they ran so fast they were ripping off their uniforms to run quicker. What could have scared them? What could have gotten rid of an army of tens of thousands of goyim? And then the Navi gets up, Elisha, and the Navi tells them what happened. You see, only a day before, the Navi stood up and said, "Klal Yisrael, things look dim, things look bad. You're under siege, you have nothing to eat, there's nowhere to go, you're locked in, we're surrounded, there's no place to run." The Navi Elisha, the day before, announced, "Today it looks bad and there's no food. Tomorrow, Hashem's going to send you the Yeshua. You're going to have so much food, you're not going to know what to do with it. You're going to have so much food that food's going to be cheap because it's going to be so plentiful. Tomorrow Hashem's going to make you an incredible miracle." And that's exactly what took place. Borei Olam made an amazing miracle. He started to make the sounds that sounded like thunder and lightning, and it sounded like horses and armies were coming over the hills. And when the Goyim heard this, they thought that other armies were coming to save the Jewish people. They were so scared that from all the rash that Hashem made in the mountains, which really was only wind, which really was only lightning and thunder, they thought it was other armies coming to save us. They dropped everything and they ran. They didn't have time to get their boots off. As they were running, they were unclothing to get out quick enough to jump on their ships and to take off. And literally in moments, Hashem made the entire army of tens of thousands run for their lives and disappear. Yeshuat Hashem keheref ayin, in a blink of an eye, mamash, mamash. When the people saw this, they ran out. And they couldn't believe it. It was true. And there's food to eat. And there's cattle. And there's animals. But as they were running out, something horrible took place. There was a shomer, a guard, that stood at the gates of the city. Now, when the word got around to all these people that were in siege for so many days and so hungry that the enemies left and the food is there to eat, they went charging out of those gates. And as they were charging out of the gates, they trampled this Shomer. They trampled him to death. And then the Navi tells you, why? Why was this man trampled to death? Writes the Navi, because the day before, when the Navi stood up in front of everyone and told everyone, today you're in bad straits, but Hashem's going to save you. And tomorrow you're going to have Yeshua. This guy, this Shomer, stood up in front of the Navi, in front of all the people, and he said, come on, Rabbi. Look how bad of a situation we're in. There's no way that Hashem can save us. There's no way that even if he opened the windows of heaven, he still couldn't drop so much food that we would have so much the way you're describing. The Navi says, what? You're questioning Hashem? You're questioning the prophecy? That man who questioned the Yeshua, he didn't get to see the Yeshua. Because you know who gets to see the Yeshua? The people that believe in him. Yeshuat Hashem keheref ayin. Rabotai, open your hearts. Isn't it a little bit funny that from everybody in the story we just mentioned, all the characters involved, would you believe that Hashem would bring the miracles and the Yeshua from four mitzora'im, from four lepers? You know what it is to get sara'at? The person has to do sins. Lashon hara and other sins. That leprosy comes from people who aren't doing the right thing. Not the people who are doing the right thing. And yet, who did Hashem bring this incredible Yeshua? Did he bring it through the Navi? No. Did he bring it through the rabbis? No. You know who he brought it through? The sinners. Because every now and then, we need a message. We need to stop believing in what it means to be a Jew. We need to start understanding that banim atem l'Hashem Elokechem. It doesn't matter what we do. It doesn't matter what we fell to. It matters what are we a part of. And if there's still a part of us left that's still unified together as one, then we're a part of a whole that's great, no matter what the individual falls to. Never forget this. To make this point, Borei Olam decided, you know where I'm going to bring Yeshua from? I'm going to bring it from the last place you expected it to come. I'm going to bring it from the guys on the outside of the city. Michutz l'machane. The guy that you wouldn't say hello to in the morning. The guy that you'd walk right by in the street, you wouldn't tell him Shabbat Shalom. Because, look at this guy. You want me to talk to him? Come on! He's not in my level. He's not in my social status. He's, one of those, but he's not one of us. God forbid. And this was the area that Sefirat HaOmer was earmarked for us to rethink. Because this is an area that Klal Yisrael can either fly or, God forbid, the opposite. That's what took place with the students of Rabbi Akiva. They were the greatest giants. And to speak about them is impossible because each one was able to be mehaya metin. We're not here to say where they went right or wrong. We could never do that. You're talking about Gidole Elyon. But the rabbis tell us that something was there on their great exalted level that didn't give respect to what it is to be another Jew. This is the area that we mechazek. How do we know this? Because when the Gemara describes the story of the plague of the 24,000 of the students of Rabbi Akiva, what does the Gemara say? When the Gemara talks about how they passed away, you know how it describes the number? The Gemara says 12,000 zugot. It doesn't say that 24,000 died. It says that 12,000 pairs passed away. Why are you counting them in pairs? Because Chazal tell us that they had their havruta. They were able to associate with their own. But the minute it came to somebody else, that was the moment that they struggled. And again, we could never say on their level, we're talking here about Gidole Elyon, but this is what the little words that Chazal tell us on our level, so that we can take home something, so that we can understand that yes, Klal Yisrael can be saved even by the lepers. Klal Yisrael can be saved even by those who in your eyes might not look like the perfect Jew, but you know what? Take a second look. Isn't that what we just read last week? Last week we spoke about the parasha of Nigaim, of Nega. Did you see what the pasuk said? This is an eye-opener. The pasuk says, V'ra'a ha-kohen, a person that finds that they have a Nega on their skin. What do? They come to the Kohen. They show it to the Kohen. You know what the pasuk says? V'ra'a ha-kohen. Kohen looks at it. And then the next words after that is, V'ra'u ha-kohen v'time oto. Wait 1 second. You already told me in the beginning of the same pasuk, V'ra'a ha-kohen. You told me once that the Kohen looked at it. Why does the same pasuk have to repeat a second time, V'ra'u ha-kohen v'time oto? You have to tell me that the Kohen looked at it twice? The answer is yes. Because when you're looking at the nega of another Jew, you can never look just once. The halacha is that the Kohen has to look at the nega once, and he's not allowed to say what he thinks until he takes a second look. And you know what we learn from here? That God forbid, if you look at another Jew, and you see that, God forbid, they might have something wrong with them, before you judge, you got to take a second look. You have to understand what it is to be a Klal Yisrael. You have to understand what it is to be a prince and princesses of Borei Olam. We're so quick and so fast to write people off. Chas v'shalom. The guy that you just wrote off might have been the guy to bring a Yeshua. I ask you, in the story of the Navi, do you think anybody walked by the gates and they saw these four guys sitting there on the floor, wrapped up in bandages, and they're in leprosy from head to toe? Do you think anybody walked up to these four guys and said, hey, mein yanin? These guys were wrapped up like mummies in sarat. When people walked by them, they went like this. I don't want to look at them. Maybe it might be catchy. I don't want to associate with those people because they're not, you know, me. It's all about me. It's all about my world. It's all about the I, you know, like in the iPhone. You know what I mean? It's me. It's all about me. It's me. It's all about the I. And everything can evolve around the I. And at the end of the day, we forget that Klal Yisrael was built on the us, the Klal, another Jew. Every Jew is a diamond. That's what the word Yisrael stands for. Yeshishim ribo otiot la Torah. There are 600,000 letters in a Sefer Torah. Because there are 600,000 neshamot in Am Yisrael. Every Jew corresponds to another letter. And if you're missing a letter from the Torah is pasul. And if you're missing a Jew from Klal Yisrael is pasul. God forbid. And that includes even the leper in your eyes. And that includes even the person that you thought is not on your level. Even the guy that might not keep in Shabbat as well as he should. Even the guy that walks in maybe, and he didn't get to the stage yet that he's wearing tzitzit every day. Even to that young lady that maybe is still struggling to step up in a way of a wonderful description or a showing of dignity of a princess and the way she dresses. But don't get there. And these are the days that we look at a ladder. These are the days of 49 steps to Matan Torah. But what are those steps? It's not just about my growth. It's about looking at someone else and saying, give them a second look, give them a second check, because you know what? They're also going up the ladder. Give them a chance. Give them a chance. You never know where the Yeshua is going to come from. And you never know who Hashem's going to pick to deliver to you a Yeshua that will blow your mind. I want to tell you about a man that the community of Flatbush, Brooklyn, New York, nobody really knew until after he passed away who he really was. And it's funny like that. There were a lot of tzaddikim out there that while they were living, we didn't really get how great they were. We didn't really kind of use their greatness or connect to them in ways that we could have. And you know how the saying goes. You don't appreciate what you have until you no longer have it. And many tzaddikim were this way. They hid themselves. They didn't want anyone really to know. I want to tell you about a gentleman that in Brooklyn, they used to nickname him Mendel the coat rack. Now, if you were ever driving around Brooklyn a few years back, you'd see that there was an older man, looks a little bit like a Hasidic type of a Jew, but he was wrapped in this plastic from head to toe. He looked like a homeless guy. He was wearing jackets and sweaters, layer after layer, pile after pile. He'd be walking up and down the streets in middle of the gutter, middle of the street, not on the sidewalk, literally in between cars. And he'd be walking with his walker, and he'd be humming, and he'd be singing, and people look at him, Mendel, what are you doing? Get out of the street. Cars are coming. Yeah. And then he's going, and people thought that he was out of his mind. And he was known to stop people, random people in the street, and say, can you give me a ride? I gave him a ride a few times. And I remember helping, I used to call him Reb Mendel, I helped him into my car, into my minivan, folded up his walker, put him in the back, and we started to drive. I said, Remendel, where do you need to go to? He said, oh, I need to go to Avenue J and Ocean Parkway. I said, no problem. I drive him through the traffic. We finally get to J and Ocean Park. Right when we pull up to the spot, he says to me, oh, I forgot. I really meant I need to go to Avenue S and Coney Island. I said, uh-huh, okay. So I turn around the corner, and I go back to Essen Coney Island. As I'm pulling up to Essen Coney Island, he says to me, wait, you know what? I forgot. The spot that you picked me up, over there on Team 13th, I really need to be there. Could you take me back to where you picked me up? Take him back. And drop him off when he picked him up. He would get out of the car, right at the spot that you picked him up in the first place, pull out his walker, and he would tell me, Adam, thank you very much. And you look at the guy, wait 1 second, we went to Avenue J, we came back to, we were doing Shiva HaKafot on Ezra, and we would look at him. I thought it was just me. But then when I started speaking to other people in the neighborhood, I heard that I wasn't only the lucky one. Many people got the opportunity to give Remendel a sightseeing tour of Flatbush, back and forth, and they would go from stop. I said, what is he wearing? And people would say, the guy's not in, come on, he's not in his right mind. And he walks in the middle of the street, he's covered with plastic, he's wearing 10 clothing. One day, Remendel comes walking down the block, right down the block from the famous shul Landau's on Avenue L and East 9th. So he walks down between K and L and East 9th, and he walks up to a house. It was early in the morning, and he knocks on the door, and it was almost 7:45 in the morning. It's pretty early to knock on somebody's door. And he knocks, and he knocks. Nobody answers. So he starts pressing the intercom, and he's holding the button down. And he's literally holding the button down. And you know what that could sound like on insult. Till finally the voice comes from upstairs to the intercom. Who is it? He says, it's Mendel. He says, you hear the voice of the wife. Oh, you may. Mendel, it's early. It's not even 8 o'clock. Mendel, what's the matter? Is your husband home? Yeah, 1 minute. The husband comes to the door. Mendel, what are you doing here? It's early. I didn't go to David yet. You know, I mean, I just came back from davening. I didn't go to eating breakfast yet. I got to get to work. What's going on? He says, no. I'm not going to bother you. He says, listen, I'm happy. I'm not going to take away from your breakfast. He says, you davened. I just want to use the bathroom. So, okay. All right. We can tell him. Okay. Well, Klal Yisrael, a Jew needs the facilities. He's homeless. So he helps Remendel up the stairs and into the house. Remendel's walking through the guy's living room with his walker step by step. And he turns back to Balabait and says, Remendel, listen. I'm quickly eating breakfast. I got to run to the city. I'm late. It's the beginning of the week. I got to get there on time. So please just use the facilities and yell out. That's it. And then go. So like this, no problem. He takes another 2 steps. He stops. He looks at the painting on the wall. This is a nice painting. He says, Remendel, do me a favor. This is not a joke. I have meetings this morning. It's Monday. It's the beginning of the week. I got to be there on time. I got to get to the city. Remendel, listen, just use the bathroom and let me go. He says, yeah, don't worry. He takes another 2 steps. He stops by the guy's brake front. He says, wow, you have beautiful crystal. Yeah, beautiful. The guy starts getting the lullaby. Says, Mendel, enough. Use the bathroom, please. Mendel says, yeah, don't worry. He wakes his way up to the bathroom and he goes inside. And then, click. 5 minutes. 10 minutes. 20 minutes. This guy is pacing back and forth, and he's pacing back and forth. What is he doing in there already? I got to get to the city. I got to get to work. So he bangs on the door. Mendel, is everything okay? Yeah, don't worry. I'm coming out in a few minutes. He bangs again. Yeah, I'm coming. Finally, the guy looks at his watch. It's already 8:20. He has to get to the city. He's already late. He has to go. He was supposed to leave already almost 25 minutes ago. He's late. So he bangs on the door. He says, Mendel, let's go. He says, yeah, I'm coming. He turns to his wife. He says, honey, listen. I got a meeting. I got to be in the city. I got to leave. I'm sorry. She says, are you crazy? You're not leaving me here. Are you joking me? Until he goes, you're not going nowhere. You're not going nowhere. The guy says, oh, hey, why am I so late? And he's pacing. He bangs and bangs. Another 5 minutes. Finally, Mendel comes out. Mendel looks around and says, I'm so sorry. But thank you so much for letting me use the facility. He starts walking out of the house and he stops. And he looks up at the wall and he says, this is a beautiful painting. He says, Mendel. Out. Arois, that's it, out. Remember leaves. Just then the man grabs his keys and then the news hits. That morning was 9/11. And he worked. He worked in the 97th floor of the first tower. And he jumps into his car and he hears the news and he just found out I was doing him a favor, or he's doing me a favor. We don't know where the Yeshua is going to come from. We don't know who Borei Olam is going to send. We know one thing. Yeshuat Hashem Keheref Ayin. That I know. How, where, what, when, who, I don't know. And I'll never know. Because every time Borei Olam wants to send a Yeshua, He'll bring it from a place that you least expected and from the person that you least expected it to come from, to open your eyes, that you'll realize that the next time you walk by that person, boy, will you give them Shalom Aleichem. Boy, will you look at them differently. Boy, will you realize, Barim Atem LaShem Elokeichem, and this is Mamash Klal Yisrael. Do you know that this man, for the rest of Reb Mendel's life, this guy, the story I just told you, he would run and look for him and bring him food. He would run and ask him to give him. He saved his life. And Reb Mendel wouldn't take a thing. He wouldn't take a thing. Wouldn't take a thing. He said, no, what are you talking about? And he said, Reb Mendel, you saved my life. I worked in the Twin Towers. They kept crashing down because of you. What are you talking about? Well, I needed to use the facilities. What are you talking about? I know it. Never forget. And that's the point. Rabbi Akiva had 12,000 zugot of students. 12,000 pairs. And they stuck in pairs. And there was something there, ben adam lechavero, that we can't understand on our level, but we can recognize when it comes to people that might not look exactly like us, or maybe not have our same last name, or maybe not have the exact status of our social circles, and because of that we don't really. And then these stories happen, and we open up our eyes. And that's why, do you know what happened after these 24,000 passed away? Rabbi Akiva started again. And do you know who was one of his main and prime students? Rabbi Meir. I want to tell you a little bit something about the great Rabbi Meir Balanis, who happens to be that his yard site is this coming Sunday. The great Rabbi Meir Balanis, the one that's buried in Tiberia, in Tiberias, the one that I'm sure everybody here who went to Israel spent that day going up north, and you went through the beautiful city of Tiberias, of Tiberia. And over there you saw nestled on the upper corner in the mountains, overlooking the Kinneret, there was the kever, there was the tomb of Rabbi Meir Balanis. It's a tomb, a kever, that people come from all over the world to pour their hearts out, because till today, Elaha de Meir Aneni. So many miracles happened by this kever. So many miracles happened through the greatness of this rabbi, Rabbi Meir. He's nicknamed Bal HaNes. It's an amazing thing. When a Jew is in trouble, you know what the Gemara says? The Jew should quickly run and start to pray. And they should give a little tzedakah. And they should say, Elaha de Meir Aneni. It's interesting, you know? We don't say on any other rabbis, Elaha, the this rabbi, Aneni. We don't say, Elaha, the Rabbi Akiva, Aneni. We don't say that. Even though he was the Rebbe and Rabbi Meir was a student. We don't say, Elaha, the Moshe Rabbeinu, Aneni. We don't say that. But there's one rabbi that we use when we're in trouble. And that's Rabbi Meir. Why? What is it about Rabbi Meir that when we're in trouble, we cry out, the God of Meir, save us? I want to tell you something. Do you know that his name wasn't even really Meir? Wasn't his real name. That wasn't his name. The Gemara tells us that Rabbi Meir's real name was Rabbi Noharai. So why did they call him Meir? Because he was Meir. He illuminated the world with Torah in such a great way that he was greater than all the other rabbis of the generation. And that's why the halacha was not like him. You know why the halacha was not like him? Because the Gemara says, Rabbi Meir gadol mechaverav. He was so much bigger than everybody else that we couldn't understand him. He was too big. And if you can't understand the halacha, you can't follow the halacha. And therefore, when the rabbis had machloket, Rabbi Meir, Rabbi Yehuda, the halacha was always like Rabbi Yehuda. Why? Because Rabbi Meir, you're too giant. And we can't get you. But Rabbi Tam, I want you to hear this. Open your hearts. There's one place. Of just a few places in Shas that the halacha is like Rabbi Meir. And we actually go after him. And you know what, that Gemara? There's a machloket in Gemara. The Gemara says, Amar Rabbi Yehuda, Banim Atem Lashem Elokechem. Amar Rabbi Yehuda, Bizman Sha'atem Nohagim Minhag Banim. You know when you consider the children of God? When you act like the children of God. That's the opinion of Rabbi Yehuda. You act well, you follow Torah, you do mitzvot, oh, you're the chosen people. Comes Rabbi Meir and argues. Says Rabbi Meir, no. Banim atem lashem elokechem. Amar Rabbi Meir, ben kach u ben kach. Banim atem lashem elokechem. Doesn't matter what you do. Doesn't matter where you fell. Doesn't matter what you fell into. You are Hashem's child, period. And you'll always be Hashem's children. And those of us who, Baruch Hashem, were gifted with children, and those who are waiting, Hashem should send them this year in the Zechut to Rabbi Meir Balanes. And those who are waiting to get married, to have beautiful families, Hashem should send them Zivugim Amitim this year, the Zechut Rabbi Meir Balanes. But Rabbi Meir said it. He said, you are Klal Yisrael, no matter what. And never lose what the erech and value and quality of what it has to look at another Jew. Never look down on another Jew, no matter what they did, no matter where they came from, no matter what they're dressed like. Remember, he's another letter in the Sefer Torah, just like you. Banim atem lashem elokechem. And in this machloket, from all the machloket in Shas, this is the machloket we pick on to be posek halacha like Rabbi Meir. Banim atem lashem elokechem. Halacha ki Rabbi Meir. And that's an amazing idea. And now you understand why. Because Rabbi Akiva, when he started over after losing 24,000 students that somehow fell short in the area of Ben Adam L'Chavero, says Rabbi Akiva, this time I'm going to start over with five giants. And you know what they're going to stand for? Rabbi Meir. Banim atem Hashem Elokech. Never to look down on another Jew. This is the ladder that we climb together on these days of Sefirat Haomer. We're all growing together. So don't take a quick look, take a second look and give somebody that benefit. Maybe they're still climbing just like you. You'll never know who the Yeshua will come from. The rabbis tell us that when Mashiach comes, you're all going to be surprised who it's going to be. And it's not going to be the person you thought. And it's going to come from a place that we least expect it. Because the Yeshua comes from the place, the person, the place that we least expect it. Unbelievable. Could you imagine? Could you imagine a person who doesn't feel that they're part of a Jewish society? And one day you happen to be coming down the block and you look at them in the eye and you give them a smile. To you, it seems like nothing. But what does it feel like to them? I want to share with you a story that I think many of you know. This is a very famous story, but that's okay. Because I want you to hear it in the way I'm going to tell it. Three mashgichim in Chile, in South America. They worked by the slaughterhouse, the slaughter plant. Thousands of people worked in this slaughter plant. It was the largest Schlachthaus. It was the largest plant in Chile. Now, when you have a size of a plant with thousands of people coming in and out, you can imagine what type of operation this was. These three mashgichim would make their way around the plant and they would watch the shehita, the processing, the salting, the soaking, and all the processing when it comes to glatt kosher meat. At the end of the day, it was only a few minutes to five, they decided that they're going to inspect one of the freezers. They went inside the freezer, they're going through all the carcasses of meat that were already shechted, hanging on hooks, and they were going through the lungs just to make sure that they're all not taref. Just when they finished their inspection, they turned around to walk out, and they couldn't believe their eyes. The door to that freezer, somehow or other, without them hearing, shut on them. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen these freezers in some of these huge slaughterhouse plants. The freezer is the size of this room. They have literally hundreds of cows hanging on hooks to be dissected after they were slaughtered. Now, they walk up, and they're banging on the walls and the door of this freezer, and the walls and the door is yay thick. And nobody can hear nothing on the inside. So they're yelling and they're screaming, and obviously the story goes back many years ago before the cell phones. They had no shot of contacting the outside, and nothing they did. Now at that time it's 5 o'clock already, most people are going home. So even the people in the surrounding area weren't there anymore. 10-15 minutes go by and they start to shake. And then another 10-15 minutes go by and they look at each other and they realize they're not going to make it. It was freezing in there. And they started to suffer from hypothermia. They literally felt like they were going. They looked at each other. They tried to huddle together. They tried to huddle in the meat. They tried everything. But after time, they just got colder and colder and they began to freeze. After being in there stuck for almost an hour and a half, and they were giving up hope on everything, they huddled together in the middle of the floor, and with their shivering purple lips, they started to say vidui. And as they finished the vidui, they collapsed on the floor, and then the door popped up. And in comes running the Spanish guard, and he grabs the three rabbis by their lapels, completely unconscious and out, and he drags them out of the freezer, calls the ambulance service, and somehow or other, they brought them back and they saved their lives. It was after that, that they came the next day, and everybody heard about the story of the rabbis that were. They came to this Spanish guard, the goy, and they said to him, the size of this plant is about a block and a half long. There's about 20 to 25 different freezers. What made you think to start checking freezers? How did you even know they were missing? There's 1,000 people that walk through the doors in the morning. There are 1,000 people that walk out at night. How do you even think to look? And you know what this guy says? He says, that's why I looked. Because there are 1,000 people that walk by me in the morning and don't say a word. But these three rabbis, every single morning, stopped. They said to me, good morning. They said to me, thank you for being here. They said to me, your job means something to us. We need the security. And every day when they left, 1,000 people would leave. And no one would say a word except for these three rabbis. On the way out, they would say, thank you for being here. You mean a lot to us. The security you're providing is great. You're doing a great job. Thank you. Have a good day. We'll catch you tomorrow morning. This Spanish guard says he would wait for it. You believe that? We're talking about a hello and a goodbye. And because he sat waiting for it, he said at the end of the day, 1,000 people left, and I didn't get my goodbye. And I was waiting for it. And I wasn't leaving without it because it meant something to my day. It was like I missed a vitamin. And he said, when I realized the rabbis didn't leave. Something's wrong. And that prompted me to think, is there something wrong? He says, I started running around the entire plant. And I'm thinking to myself, maybe they're locked in somewhere. So I started checking freezer after freezer after freezer. And that was the fourth freezer. And when I opened it up, there they were on the floor. What saved their lives? Decency. A recognition. And that's to a goy. Kal v'chomer ben beno klal Yisrael. Well, you have a gem standing in front of you. You just have to be able to see it. That's the days and the climb of this ladder. Because when we came to Matan Torah, we came as a nation, not as individuals. Vayichan Sham Yisrael neged hahar ki ish echad ubelev echad. That was a condition for Torah. You're united, I'll give you the greatest blessing in the world, the Torah. You're not united, nothing doing. So we relive the climb of unity every single year in these 49 days. And we have the students of Rabbi Akiva to remind us. And we have Rabbi Meir and his yard site who falls out in middle of the Sefirah to remind you that this is one of the places we paskin like Rabbi Meir. Banim atem lashem elokechem. Benkach ubenkach. No matter what the Jew did, he's still daddy's son, daddy's little girl. He's still Klal Yisrael. He's still a Jew. Nothing to talk about. Never look down on another Jew. What a message. The message of who saves us at times when the last place we'd expect it to come from. Ah, it's amazing. I just want to sign off with this idea. In our shul, back in Brooklyn, in Magen Avraham, we decided that we were going to make a program for public school kids in Brooklyn. And that's why it's so comforting to speak about this topic in a Chazak event. Because the people from Chazak, they're walking spirits, angels around the neighborhood, saving the lives of kids. And back in Brooklyn, we don't have an organization yet, but we decided to start at least as a shul. We knew that there was at least 300 or 400 different Jewish kids in our neighborhood in public school. We wanted to change that. We wanted to give them the most precious thing you can give to a child, a Torah education, with a support system that they can feel good about themselves, with an incentive so that they'll keep coming back. And when we started sending different guys to the parks where a lot of the public school kids hang out, and they started recruiting, we didn't realize what we were getting into. When we started the program the first week, we started with 11 kids. 11 kids. And I remember that first week. We called it, and please forgive me for this. Well, let me describe it to you. When a kid walks into the room as the program's beginning, so he walks up to his friends, yo bro, yo bro, bro, yo bro, bro. So we called it the Yo Bro program. It was great. So every time they come in, they're high-fiving each other, bro, bro, yo bro, bro. And that just reminds them of the program again and again and again. So we named it the Yo Bro program. Bro. And we decided to start it one night a week and then to move it on to multiple nights. We started to decide as an after-school program, and then when they get a little stronger and they learn better Aleph Bet and they get a little bit more of a drive to want to learn, we'll push him, Bezat Hashem, to go to yeshiva. So it's going to start in steps, and this was step one. Step one, just to connect them to Judaism, to give them Jewish pride. And do you know what I do in these programs when I teach these kids? All I do is tell them stories. I tell them stories about Tzaddikim, but I also tell them stories about young Tzaddikim, kids, just like them, who did incredible things, inspiring them to go places and want more in life, and to be bigger, and not to settle for the vanilla of life, but to go out and become something that can change Klal Yisrael. So we started that first week with 11 kids. And you know how it goes. Anytime you try to start something good, the Yetzer Hara shows up, and he tries his best to mess it from the get-go, right at the first minute of the program. If you would think for a moment, what can go so bad on a program like that? I'll tell you what can go so bad. We were bringing these 11 public school kids into the shul, and just then, some of the older men who just finished Minchan Arbi, they're walking out. And one old man who's not part of the shul, because my shul is mostly, the demographic of my shul is mostly 16 to 35. The oldest guy is 35, except for the rabbi. But the oldest guy is 35. So it turns out that this older man who just came in from the street, not part of the shul, but he prayed with us that day, he's walking out of the shul, and this old man sees one of the public school kids walking through the door of the shul, and the kid is wearing diamond stud earrings. In both ears. I had to tell you that, that's a chidush, in both ears. So the old man looks at the kid, and he says to him, "Look at you, you're wearing earrings. What type of Jewish kid wears earrings?" And he starts going off on this kid, and he starts... And I said, "Shema Yisrael, would you let the kid at least walk through the front door?" And he was, and this poor kid didn't know what hit him. He was told that this is going to be a program, that there's going to be incentives, and then after that we take him to Holy Schnitzel, and we get him a Holy Toasty, and everything's holy about this program. And then when this kid walks through the door, he gets smashed on the head. Holy cow, what happened here? I don't understand. What are you doing to me? This is what I came for, to get over the head? So right away when I saw this, I ran to the front door. I grabbed this kid, literally like he was my own child. I grabbed this kid, and I looked at the old man and I said, "Come on. Come on, he's a good kid. Leave him alone." And the other said, "Ah," and he walks out. You remember old Mr. Scrooge? Yeah, he walks out. So I look at this kid and I say, "Nah, he's not part of the shul, don't worry, just don't forget about it. Just don't worry, we love you, you're great, go downstairs." He goes downstairs. Now I'm thinking to myself, my heart was crying for this kid. Really, can you imagine your first step into a shul in years, and that was the Shalom Aleichem? So I went downstairs and I said in the back of my head, when I start teaching the class, I gotta do something with this kid. Gotta do something with this kid. All right. So I start to teach the class. And I start telling them about stories of Sadiqim and Baba Sali and Rabbi Meir Balanes and all different beautiful stories. And as I'm giving the class to these 11 kids, I zero in on this kid with the earrings. And I say to the kid, "Hey, you know, you have such an angelic face." He really did. He had a face that illuminated. It's such a neshama, such a pure face. That's such an angelic face. So I said to him, "Angel, you understand? Did you hear the story I just said?" And he said, "Rabbi, my name, I know what your name is, but you have an angelic face. You're the angel of this place. So did you get this story?" He says, "Yeah, Rabbi, I loved it." I said, "Great, wonderful." We finished the story, everybody's leaving, and I said, "Hey, angel, come here a second." He comes up to me, I say, "Listen, I don't know how to say this, but I'm married for 20 years and my 20th anniversary now is coming up. I'm in the market for diamond studs. So maybe you could hook up a brother, you know what I'm saying? You can tell me where you got the good, they're gorgeous. I don't know how else to describe studs." I said, they're like, you know, he says, "Rabbi, I got a friend, he works it." I said, "Does he sell it or does he, you know, he sells it." I said, "Good." I said, "Can you give me his number? Maybe, you know, he can give me a deal because my anniversary's coming up." He says, "Rabbi, don't worry, I got you. I got you." I said, "Okay." He says, "Next week, I'm coming back, I'll get you the number, and this, thank you. Angel, you're a dog." I said, "Rabbi, you really like him? I love him. I love him." I said, "Up to me, I take him right off your ears right now. I love him." If it was up to me. "I love him." The kid walked out 10 feet tall. And because of the name, he walked out with wings. And he flew out in a shul. I want you to open up your hearts. Because the next week, that next Tuesday, And by the way, if anybody is in Brooklyn, Tuesday nights at 6:30, coming to the shul, 2066 East 9th Street, between T and U, you want to meet the guys? It's not 11 guys anymore, it's over 130 guys now. But this story is where it started from. And these were one of the founders, this kid. So the next week, open your hearts, listen to this. Next Tuesday. So the 11 musketeers come back. And they bring friends. Because they heard about Holy Schnitzel. And they heard that the story wasn't that bad either. And they come back. The next week we have the Ayin Hara, almost 18 kids. They all come in. I get up, I tell the story. Angel, what do you think about? Rabbi, I love the story. I made him the highlight of the class. We're still doing damage control. We're still healing the wounds. And when the class was over, he runs up to me and says to me, Rabbi. And then suddenly I take a closer look. He's wearing a baseball cap. And the baseball cap is over his ears. And he says to me, Rabbi, I have something for you. And I look at his ears and I say, uh-oh. And he pulls out a box and he hands me the box. And I look at this kid and I said to myself, either those are CZs or this kid's an angel. And he opened up the box and I said, don't do that. I will not take your studs. He says, Rabbi, please. It would mean the world to me. He says, I worked 3 summers for these studs, but I want you to give it to your wife. I said, hey, don't do it. Thank you. You're an angel. But it looks better in your ears. He says, Rabbi, you mean? I says, yes, just give me the guy's number and I'll call him. I said, but you're my angel. The kid took the studs back and he walked out and you had to see the look on his face. You don't know where the Yeshua is going to come from and you don't know who it's going to come from. Don't put them down. They're Klal Yisrael, Banim Atem Lashem Elokechem. Because now I'm going to make you cry. Because there's an end to this story that you didn't hear. And the end of this story goes that this program took off and went into the hundreds. And every week you can come and check this out. But at the end of the day, over the years, the kids after high school went their own way. Some to yeshivot, some to college. An angel, after 3 years, disappeared. I didn't know what happened to him. One day I'm driving down Avenue U. And I drive right up to a red light. And I look to my right. And there's a bunch of guys. And they're horsing around with each other, jumping all the time. And I said to myself, you know, a bunch of guys. I didn't know they were Jewish. All of a sudden, I take a second look and I hear 2 guys scream, Rabbi Duvi! I said, oh my God, they're Jewish. I roll down the window, I pull over the car. And these guys come running up. And then I take a second look. And one of those 4 guys is Angel. And now he's tall. I didn't see him in a few years. He went his own way. But there was something still very special about this kid, like all the others. And he looks at me and says, Rabbi, I didn't see you the longest time, and I miss you. And I said, Angel, I miss you. What's going on? How's life? And we start catching up. And as we're talking back and forth, his friend turns to him and says, hey, Angel. I said, wow, they're all cool. Angel, show the rabbi. He says, no, I'm not going to show it. No, show it to him. Show the rabbi. He says, no, I'm not going to show it to him. I thought they were talking about tzitzit. Because I know Angel put on tzitzit and he never took it off. He says, show the rabbi. You'll see. He's going to love it. He says, no, I'm too embarrassed. Finally, I tell him, I say, Angel, well, what's the deal? What? He says, okay, fine. He reaches into his shirt and I thought he was going to pull out tzitzit. Instead, he pulls out a necklace. And at the bottom of this necklace was hanging a little cherub, a little angel. And he says, ever since the day I left your program, I went out and bought this. I wear it every day. When I wake up in the morning, I look at it, and I remember the rabbi, who was the only one I ever met who called me an angel. And that's what makes me put on tefillin every single morning. And I have not missed a morning of tefillin ever since I left. Banim atem lashem elokechem. Thank you for listening, ladies and gentlemen.